Christmas time. Don't you just love it? Christmas time in our society means different things to different people. To some people, Christmas is a time for gifts. It's a time for trees and decoration. It's a time to place wreaths on the door, to have reindeer, and to celebrate Santa Claus. To some, it's a reason for anger, because there's so much talk about God and Jesus Christ. After all, the very word Christmas reminds us of our Savior, and some people have a problem with that. To some, Christmas is difficult because of finances or because of loneliness or because of a painful memory around the holiday season. And it's also for various other reasons that people struggle at Christmas time. But to the child of God, Christmas time is a time to celebrate the coming of the King into the world. It's a time to worship Him. It's a time to thank Him. It's a time to remember Him and to rejoice in all of His grace and that He is our Redeemer. It's a time of joy, peace, and hope as we think about and take time to think about all that God had done to redeem us, a sinful, lost child, to Himself. One of the issues that we must confront every Christmas is the very nature of Christ Himself. To be honest, we Christians have some pretty amazing claims based on the scriptures of who Jesus is. We claim that He is the very Son of God. We claim that He is the only way to salvation for all people in the world. There is no other way except through Jesus Christ. We make these claims because they are built on the foundation of the Scriptures, the Holy Bible, which is God's Word to us. And one of the most beloved Christmas carols that Christians sing during the time of year that we are celebrating was sung today, "What Child Is This?" And that is what I've titled today's message. It was written by William C. Dix, and the lyrics prompt us to contemplate the identity of who our Savior is. In fact, the carol politely but persistently presses the fact for us to answer the question, is this child truly a holy infant born of a virgin? That's the question we must ask. Dr. John MacArthur quotes Dr. Walbrood, who was the former president of the Dallas Theological Seminary, and he said these words. He said, "The incarnation of the Lord Jesus Christ is the central fact of Christianity, and upon it, the whole superstructure of Christian theology depends on it." He stresses the truth of the virgin birth of our Lord Jesus Christ as the foundational, non-negotiable doctrine of Christianity. To deny the virgin birth is to deny the very Word of God. To deny the virgin birth is to deny the very deity of Jesus Christ. To deny the virgin birth is to deny the gospel. To deny the virgin birth is to be lost in sin and headed to hell. Today, as we ponder what child is this, I want to ask and answer the question, why the virgin birth? What child is this? I want us to consider the important doctrine today and to give you some clear truths that are found in the passage we're going to look at that tell us why God sent His Son through the womb of a virgin. And I want you to notice these truths with me today as we look to God's Word in Galatians chapter 4, verses 4 through 6. So if you'll turn there, if you're not already there, read these words with me. "When the time came of completion, God sent His Son, born of a woman, born under the law, to redeem those under the law so that we might receive adoption as sons. And because you are sons, God sent the Spirit of His Son into our hearts." May God bless the reading of His Word. Father, we are so blessed and grateful to celebrate Your virgin birth at this time of year, and I pray that as we examine the scriptures today that You will speak to our hearts, that we will see the doctrines that we hold dear come to life in the very words that You preserved in the scriptures. Lord, may the words of my mouth and the meditations of my heart be found acceptable in Your sight. And may we all glorify and honor you as King of Kings and Lord of Lords, and as in the blessed name of our Lord and Savior, who was born that day 2,000 plus years ago to be our Savior, Jesus Christ. In his name we pray, amen. The first thing I want us to see as we examine this passage of Scripture to answer the question, what child is this and why the virgin birth matters, is the record of the virgin birth. The record of the virgin birth. Notice Jesus came and history marks the birth of his arrival. And Paul's words cause us to reflect on the very timing of when his appearance came. What does it say in verse 4? It says, when the time came of completion. The time when Jesus came is said to have been time at its fullest point. It was a unique occasion when all of the parts of history had come together. All of those things that had to occur did occur. And each and every detail that was necessary was now in place. Clearly, Paul wants us to realize the timing of the historical appearance of the Father, Son. That was something that was agreed upon from the beginning of time, not just some happenstance. When the time fully came of completion, that is when Jesus arrived on this earth. The Apostle Peter adds that the timing of the Son's arrival was a date that the prophets of old diligently searched out and sought to understand. And Peter says in 1 Peter chapter 1, verses 10 through 12, concerning this salvation, the prophets who prophesied about the grace that would come to you searched and carefully investigated. They inquired into what time and what circumstances the Spirit of Christ within them was indicating when he testified in advance to the sufferings of Christ and the glories that would follow. It was revealed to them that they were not serving themselves but you. These things we have now announced to them through you who preached the gospel to you by the Holy Spirit sent from heaven. Angels long to catch a glimpse of these things. 1 Peter chapter 1, verses 10 through 12. These verses and the verses we looked at in Galatians show us the realization that the timing of Christ's birth was in accordance to the very determination and the very will of God the Father. He ordained all of these things to come to pass. And the world has a record of the virgin birth. So if Christ's birth took place when the time came of completion, what did that completion look like? Well, it was a time of political preparation. The Roman Empire had brought the Pax Romana, which is the peace of Rome, to the known world and to the world. It was united like it had never been before under their rule. It was a time of economic preparation. The Romans had constructed a fine transportation system that focused on five main highways that led from Rome to other destinations in the ancient world. It was a time of cultural preparation. The Greek language had become the medium of commerce and culture and philosophy, so it was possible for the gospel message to reach a universal audience because of that taking place. And finally, it was a time of religious preparation. A famine of the soul had come upon the world. Individually and as a society, the failures of paganism and even Judaism in itself, along with the revival of the messianic hopes, characterized much of the known world at that time when this time of completion had come. Therefore, when the time came to completion, that leads us to the truth that politically, economically, culturally, religiously, and historically, had been orchestrated by the one true God for all of those things to come to pass, for all of those things to come together in his timing by the one true God. By his sovereignty, by his providence, the historical events of Rome and Jerusalem, both which figured prominently in the Lord's mission on this earth, they had converged together. And that appointed date for the debut of the Son that came, Jesus Christ, arrived right on schedule as it had always been planned. What child is this in the manger then? He is the child that is born when the time came of completion. Next, notice with me the reality of the virgin birth. Verse 4 tells us when he says that Jesus is called the child who was born of a woman, that these words reflect on the circumstances of his birth. That should cause us to reflect on the humiliation in which Christ came. In Philippians chapter 2, we're told that Jesus left the throne. He was ruling, and he left, and he came to this earth. Now, how could have he come? Ponder that for a moment. Think about that for a moment. How could have Christ come when he left his throne in heaven? He could have come with the angels. He could have come in his power. He could have come in his might. He could have come and overthrown the Roman government, which is what caused so much problem for the Jews, because that's what they expected Christ to do when he came. They got their advents mixed up. The first time he came was to model humiliation, to model love. So he came as the lowliest form of life, an infant. Can an infant care for itself? No. Can an infant protect itself? No. Christ came in all of his humility and relied on mankind to care for him until he could ultimately fulfill the mission God had for him. He was born of a woman in agreement with Isaiah 7:14. Therefore, the Lord himself will give you a sign. See, the virgin will conceive, have a son, and name him Emmanuel. God with us. He was thus fully human as well as fully divine. He is and was the one and only God-man. And the Bible teaches us that there was something different about his birth. God said he would send his son, born of a woman, in this passage. And the implication of that statement is that Jesus Christ came into the world without the benefit or aid of a human male. Jesus didn't have a human father. He was created in the womb by the Holy Spirit. Why is that important? That fact alone makes his birth unique. His birth is special because of that understanding of the reality of the virgin birth. It tells us that there was something unusual about that birth of our Lord Jesus Christ. His birth is the fulfillment of ancient prophecy. When Adam and Eve sinned, if you'll remember, when Adam and Eve sinned against God in the Garden of Eden, God pronounced judgment on them. And that judgment fell upon Adam and Eve together, and all of their descendants, according to Romans chapter 5. And as God pronounces his sentence on the human race and upon Satan, he makes a startling prophecy in Genesis 3:15. Do you remember that verse? I will put hostility between you and the woman and between your offspring and her offspring. He will strike your head and you will strike his heel. That prophecy says that the offspring of the woman will destroy the serpent. What makes this prophecy so amazing is that when the Redeemer comes, he will be human. He will not be born through the standard means, because it is a supernatural birth. It is through the birth of a virgin. And that's the first hint that the birth of the Redeemer will be different. All the way back in Genesis at the very beginning. The description of born of a woman tells us more about this child. He's not only made and formed in the woman, but he is of her. That is, he was part of her flesh and blood, and he took on those parts. He was not born of man, therefore the sin nature was not imparted upon Jesus. And he was conceived by the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mother. The whole point is this: when Mary conceived the Lord Jesus in her womb, she was a virgin. She remained a virgin until after he was born. Matthew 1:25 tells us that. So what child is this then? He is the child who was born of a woman, just as he was the child for whom all time had waited for the completion when it was perfect. Paul then says Jesus was born under the law. And he adds that to the phrase born of a woman, and that phrase refers to another circumstance that marks his birth, and it features again to his uniqueness. From his circumcision 8 days after his birth to the celebration of Passover to with his disciples just before his death, to every detail of his life, it was under the direction of the law. As the son of Abraham, the son-born servant lived under the instruction of the ceremonial law. Jesus said he didn't come to destroy the law. He came to fulfill it. For the sake of the ritual ordinances and the shadows of the law were instituted, their principal end and fulfillment were found in Christ and in Christ alone. The Son was also born under the moral law and the civil law, and as a servant of the the Lord was subject to all the precepts of the law, to its rewards as well as its penalties. And the law of God demanded righteousness. So the Son, Jesus, was born of a woman, and he was under the law. No wonder the author of Hebrews in Hebrews 10 can say, when Christ came into the world, he said, "Behold, I have come to do your will, O God, as it is written of me in the scroll of the book." What child is this in the manger? He is not only the child born when the time came to completion. Not only is he the one who came born of a woman, he is also the child that was born under the law. And continuing with this passage, we see the results of the virgin birth. We see the results of the virgin birth. Why did God go to all this trouble? Why did God put forth so much effort to bring his Son into the world the way that he did? Why wouldn't he just use some other great man to accomplish his perfect plan? Why not use Abraham or Moses or David? Why not use them? Why did God use something like a virgin to bring the Redeemer into the world? Why is that important? He did it that way because there was no human qualified for sinners to be redeemed. Because none of us are perfect. So it had to be another way. Paul continues in his discussion of Jesus, and he provides an additional part of his answer to the question before us. The babe in the manger, the child who was born for a reason. And the results of his birth tell us that he was here to redeem those of us who were under the law. Here our focus shifts from the circumstance of Jesus' coming to the purpose of his coming. We need to pay attention to the meaning of the background of the words here, because the word redeem is an act of rescuing. It's a releasing, it's a delivering from slavery by the payment of a price. What was the price that Christ paid? He died. He gave his life so that we might find life. The price paid for the nation's deliverance from Egypt was profound. Do you remember what it was? The first Passover. It was the death of the firstborn. Through Moses, Israel learned of God's penal substitute for their firstborn, and thus Israel offered a Passover lamb, and they saw their redemption from slavery in Pharaoh's kingdom to liberty under the rule of their God. There is thankfully a redemption greater than that of Moses. Israel's deliverance in Egypt exemplified the gospel fully revealed in Jesus Christ, and that is what we get to be a part of. He was the Lamb. He poured out himself in death so that his people might be set free. So great was the redemption by Christ that he bought a benefit that Moses could not provide: the forgiveness of sins, which you and I are desperately in need of. Amen. Believe it or not, there's still more in this passage. Notice in verse 4 where it says, those whom the Son redeems as those under the law. This tells us that the Son came to redeem us, but what is the point of this description being included here? His point is to let us know that he came to reach even us, those who were sinners, those who were condemned under the law, those who are in bondage to sin, those of us who are powerless to overcome. His point was to get our attention. Luke 2 tells us that Jesus brings good tidings of great joy. We don't need to be fearful of his coming. He came to rescue us. He came to release us from the bondage of sin. In life and in his death, the Son rendered to God the obedience that was required by the law. And on that basis, he asked the Father to apply what was applied to him to be applied to us. Therefore, we are covered in his righteousness because of what Christ did. So what child is this? He is the child from whom all history has waited. He is the child that was born of a woman under the law, sent to redeem us. And finally, the reasons for the virgin birth. According to verse 5, he is the child who was born to make us heirs of God. As Paul puts it, he says that we might receive adoption as sons. And because you are sons, God sent the Spirit of his Son into our hearts, Christ came so that we might be heirs with him, that we might have all of the rights and all of the privileges that Christ has, to live with the Father, to be in his presence. In these words, we learn the ultimate reason of the Savior coming, and it was to have his Spirit indwell within our hearts. Jesus came so that we might be saved. Do you remember what he said to Nicodemus in John chapter 3, verse 17 and 18? He said, "For God did not send the Son into the world to condemn the world, but to save the world through him." The world is already condemned. Anyone who believes in him is not condemned, but anyone who does not believe is already condemned because he has not believed in the name of the one and only Son of God. That's why Jesus came. And adoption gives us great privileges. And if you look back historically at what adoption meant in the Roman world, in which the people Paul was writing to in Galatia, it was widely practiced. So they were very familiar with it. Roman emperors would adopt men not related to them by blood in order to give their office and their authority on to another. They couldn't have a child of their own, so they would adopt one and bring him in, and then they would continue on with their dynasty. But more broadly speaking, when a son was adopted, he was equal with those born into his family. The adopted son had the same name. He had the same inheritance. He had the same standing. He had the same rights of a natural born son. But there was one element that was different. You could never revoke an adopted son's place in the family. You could disown your own child, but you could not disown an adopted son. That's pretty powerful. And to appreciate the stunning reality of our placement and heirs in the household of God, we need to remember how God viewed us before our adoption. Apart from the grace of adoption, what were we? We weren't children of God. We were children of disobedience, according to Ephesians. We were by nature not children of God, but rather children of wrath. We were condemned. We're condemned to hell without Christ. The point is, through adoption, the Father gives us full rights and privileges that belong to his own Son, Jesus Christ. So let me ask you this question as we get close to closing. What if Jesus had never come? What if Jesus had never come? If Christ had not come, how would the world be different than what it is today? Just for a moment, imagine some powerful hand was wiping the known understanding of Jesus Christ, that he never existed. Every element of his life was erased from our minds. Every element was erased from society and from civilization. You would go to a library, there'd be no historical trace of Jesus there. It had all vanished. There'd be no entries in the encyclopedia on Jesus Christ. They'd be all removed. There'd be no Christmas carols. There'd be no Project Angel. There'd be no Operation Christmas Child. We wouldn't be singing "Away in a Manger" or "I'll Be Home for Christmas." There'd be no Christmas Eve services because there would be no Christmas to celebrate. All of the art in the museums about the Transfiguration, the Last Supper, the Christ on the cross, they would be gone. They'd be empty spaces. Those works would never be known to man. The great masters would be gone. The great cathedrals of Europe would be gone. The great poems of Dante and Milton and Wordsworth and Tennyson, all gone, vanished without a trace. If Christ had not come, all of the churches and all of the good work and all of the good deeds that have been done throughout history would be erased from memory. The Bible, the Holy Word of God, would be gone. No church would exist anywhere if Christ did not come. No New Life Baptist Church. We would not be here. This building would not be here. No people would come through its doors. No staff would exist. No choir would sing. There'd be no sanctuary. I'd have nothing to preach if there was no Christ. We'd have no youth, no children, no Bible studies, no mission. None of these things would exist. Those things that we often take for granted would not be around for us to enjoy. All of it would be gone, vanished into the mist if Christ had not come. But the news gets much worse than that. If Christ had not come, the promises of God would be unfulfilled. If Christ had not come, the world would still be suffering in darkness. If Christ had not come, there would be no bridge to build across the gulf of sin. If Christ had not come, we would not know that God is love. If Christ had not come, there would be no gospel to believe in. If Christ had not come, there would be no Christmas or Easter. If Christ had not come, there would be no hope beyond the grave. We would die and that would be it. If Christ had not come, we would still be lost because there would be no need for a Savior for sin. If Christ had not come, there would be no good news to preach to the nations. Thankfully, though, praise be to God and for Him all glory that Jesus did come and He was born under the law to redeem those under the law so that we might receive that adoption as sons. And because we are sons, God sent His Spirit to live and dwell in our hearts. He was born a Jew under the law. He was born a servant. So what child is this in the manger then? He is the Son of God who came to serve, not be served. He is the child who was born to set us free and to adopt us as sons into His family. When the child arrived at the time of completion, He was born of a woman born under the law, and He remains the eternal Son of God who was sent to redeem us from our sins and to give us claim to the heir. Without the virgin birth, there is no Savior. Without the virgin birth, there is no salvation. Without the virgin birth, there is no Christmas, and there is no other reason to celebrate. If Jesus Christ had not come in the world, if He came like the rest of us, then He would be no different than you and I. He would have been a sinner who would have needed a Savior himself. All His claims to be God, all His claims to be the Messiah would be nothing more than a big hoax. But thankfully, He did arrive through the virgin birth. Thankfully, He came as God intended Him to come. Thankfully, He was obedient even unto the point of death. And thankfully, He is the Son of God and not some other man. He is who He claimed to be. He was born of the virgin, just as the Bible says. He was born without sin. He lived without sin. And when He died to take away sin. You can believe the Bible. You can believe the gospel. You can trust in Jesus Christ with the salvation of your soul. And it can live in eternity with Him. This is why Christ came. What child is this? He is the Redeemer. He is the Savior. He is the King of Kings. He is the Lord of all. And Merry Christmas to you today. Thank You, Lord, for this word of truth. Thank You that we can know You as Lord. Thank You that You redeemed us from the bondage of sin. Thank You that You have set us free from its captivity. Thank You that You were born of a virgin, just as the Bible says. Thank You that you are holy. Thank You that You are God. Thank You that you loved me while I was still a sinner. Even before I was born, even before I was in the womb of my mother, You knew me. Thank You for being faithful. Thank You for loving us. Thank You for being God's only Son, born of a virgin, so that I might find life and find it abundantly. Lord, today as we reflect on this message, I pray that our hearts are stirred. I pray that we are open to sharing that wonderful message with others. People are searching for the peace that we have as Christians. They are searching for hope to get through the day. They have answers, and those of us who know the Lord is our Savior have the answer they're looking for, and that is Jesus Christ Himself. Help us to proclaim the truth of what we know to be true from the Scriptures. And let us point others to You by loving them, by providing for their physical needs where we can, by inviting them to church, by investing in their lives to make disciples of them. Lord, help us to be all that You want us to be. But But most importantly, if there is someone here in the sound of my voice that does not know you as their Savior, I pray that today would be their day of salvation. That's why you came. You told us you would not abandon us when you left us physically, and you were faithful to that. You sent the Holy Spirit, and He indwells within us. He gives us the power to overcome. I pray, Lord, if they're here today, that they would do what the Bible says, that they would confess with their mouth and believe in their heart that Jesus is Lord, and that you would set them free and lead them on a journey of righteousness from this day forth. One that is filled with purpose, one that is filled with hope, one that is filled with love and joy and peace. Thank you for all you do. And I ask that you continue to have your way with us today. In Jesus' name, amen.